Morning.
Yeah, good morning, Dr. Shailesh Mohita, sir. Yes. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Fine, sir.
Good morning, Dr. Mohita. I'm Dr. Namit Gupta, Director of Engineering at Sri Vaishno Vidyapeeth Vishwavidyalaya, Indore.
Very good morning, sir.
Good morning. Good morning, Shailesh, sir.
Good morning, madam.
Happy to see you, sir.
Namrata ma'am, can we begin with the session, because Dr. Pachauri might join us in few minutes. Probably he's somewhere out of network because his phone is not catching. So we can proceed with the session, I suppose.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. I'll start with the session. I suppose Jagdish Arora sir was here. He's not here right now because of maybe some network issue, but still I'll start because it's already 10:39 and we do have a minimum time right now. So shall I start?
Yeah, please, we can begin with.
Okay, fine. I'll start with. Good morning to eminent speakers of the plenary session, respected Dr. Pachauri, Dr. Arora and Dr. Mohite, and respected Honorable Vice Chancellor Sir, Dr. Upinder Dhar Sir, and Dean Ma'am and Conference Convener Dr. Santosh Dhar Ma'am in absentia, and the chairpersons and all delegates. Knowledge is not a commodity to be traded between expert and novice. Rather, it is a construction of ideas negotiated by the learner in a social setting. For the same purpose, we are here. And I, Dr. Pragya Charolia, welcome you all for the second plenary session of Sanmantrana 2021, a multidisciplinary international congress on good practices and capacity building for sustainable development goals. The eminent speaker for this plenary session are Dr. Ram Vilas Pachauri, Professor, IIT Indore, Dr. Jagdish Arora, Advisor, National Board of Accreditation, and Dr. Shailesh Mohite, Professor and Head, Forensic Medicine, Mumbai. The chairperson for the plenary session are Dr. Namit Gupta, Director, SVIT, Indore, and Dr. Kavita Sharma, Professor and Coordinator, SVIFS, Indore. First speaker for the session is Dr. Ram Vilas Pachauri. Dr. Pachauri is Professor at Department of Electrical Engineering, Indian Institute of Technology, Indore. He is also a visiting professor at School of Medicine, Taylor's University, Malaysia. He is an associate editor of Electronics Letter, Biomedical Signal Processing and Control Journal, and an editor of IETE Technical Review Journal, and a senior member of IEEE, and a fellow of IETE and IET. He has more than 210 publications and has been listed in the top indexed scientist in the area of computer science and electronics. He has served on review board for more than 100 scientific research journals and served for scientific committees as well for various national and international conferences. He has delivered more than 130 talks in various conferences, workshops, short-term courses and institutes. Our second speaker for the session is Dr. Jagdish Arora, currently advisor, National Board of Accreditation, and was the director of Infilbit Center as well. He was the founder, national coordinator for Ishodh Sindhu, the national consortium. Dr. Arora is recipient of several national and international awards, including Fulbright Professional Fellowship in Library and Information Science as well. Dr. Arora was awarded a citation and memento for his commendable contribution to digital initiatives for higher education by former President of India. Dr. Arora has more than 100 research articles to his credit, and that were published in learned research journals, and is a chapters in book and conference proceeding as well. Our next speaker is Dr. Shailesh Mohite. Dr. Shailesh Mohite is Professor and Head, Forensics Medicine Science, Dobiwala National Medical College and Nair Hospital, Mumbai. He is a President of Medico-Legal Association of Maharashtra, member of Quality Assurance Committee of Mumbai District for Maternal Death Review, member of Senate of Maharashtra University of Health Sciences, member of Board of Study of MUHS, nodal officer of multidisciplinary child protection cell at Nair Hospital as well. He has conducted and supervised more than 10,000 autopsies till date. He is a faculty for Maharashtra Judicial Academy since 2008, conducting training for judges and public prosecutors. He has appeared as government witness in many cases for Maharashtra Police, SBI and NIA as well. On behalf of Sri Vaishnav Vidyapeeth Vishwavidyalaya, I welcome all these speakers in this plenary session. Now, as a chairperson, we do have Dr. Namit Gupta. He is presently working as director of Sri Vaishnav Institute of Technology and Science, SVV Indore. He is an experienced professor with a demonstrated history of working in the education management industry, skilled in lecturing, curriculum development, e-learning and research. He has published more than 75 papers in various national and international journals of reputation. He has got one patent in process for formation of capacitor structure for non-volatile memory of germanium nanocrystals. As a part of the IQAC team of the university, he is also working with his team for the timely and practical implementation of new education policy 2020 in SVV. Our second chairperson for the session is Dr. Kavita Sharma. Dr. Kavita Sharma is a professor in the Department of Applied Chemistry and coordinator for Sri Vaishnav Institute of Forensic Science, SVV Indore. She has initiated many activities like techno management cultural events. She has published more than 20 research papers of national and international repute and presented more than 40 research papers. She has organized more than 30 workshops and training programs as well as conferences. She has been a part of international congress conferences regularly as a fellow member of International Congress of Chemistry and Environment. She is also a life member of Indian Science Congress Association, Global Initiatives of Academic Network, to name a few. She has received Best Research Papers Presentation Awards in international and national platforms as well. Now, I would like to hand over the session to Dr. Namit Gupta, sir, for further proceedings. Sir, please.
Thank you, Dr. Pragya Jarolia, and once again, very warm good morning on this cold day in the winters of Malwa region. And I, on behalf of Sri Vaishnav Vidyapeeth Vishwavidyalaya, I once again welcome our speakers today for the plenary session two. I welcome Dr. Jagdish Arora sir, Dr. Shailesh Mohite sir, and Dr. R.B. Pachauri. However, Dr. Pachauri may be joining us in some half an hour because he is out of network right now. But then, let us not wait for that. We'll start the show. As the theme of this whole particular Sanmantrana 2021, a multidisciplinary conference goes, is that we are now concentrating on good practices and capacity building for sustainable development goals. Now, we all people are basically from the science and technology background in this plenary session today. And we know that goals of sustainable development can be achieved through the efforts of scientific and technological community. And there are many issues, you know. COVID, Corona has really created an issue of, you know, fighting with diseases. And that is where the good practices and capacity building for the sustainable development goals is really important, really playing a major role. So science can actually play a major role here. Issues such as fighting with diseases like COVID or over-urbanization of the cities, overpopulation, one of the most popular type of problem which we have since last 70-75 years. Then in the today's world of information technology flow, it is also very important that the impact of this overflow of this information technology or information and its negative sides also has to be seen. And we have to find out certain ways and methods in which we can actually make a balance between all the things. And, you know, United Nations is also very much worried about, sustainable development things and all those things. And they have listed in some 2002 or 3, they have listed certain 8 goals, which they say, and I quote here, to eradicate extreme poverty and hunger. That is the first goal. To achieve universal primary education, second goal. To promote gender equality and to empower women. That is the third goal. Reduce child mortality, improve maternal health, combat with the malaria, HIV AIDS, and now COVID-like diseases, and then ensure environmental sustainability, and finally to develop a global partnership for development. These are 8 goals which were set by United Nations in 2002-03. And to achieve these goals, the major areas in which we actually need to work to have a sustainable development type of environment, first and the foremost is water and sanitation. Second is the energy, because now energy consumptions and energy requirements are growing day by day, and new methods of energy generations are picking up very rapidly, like renewable energy, in which we can include solar energy as one of the most important part of the sustainable development goal, of achieving the sustainable development goal, because the energy requirements of the country are growing year by year and day by day, and to meet up that, the government of India is also working very strongly. We have also been part of major role player in International Solar Alliance of all the countries which are actually having a good ample amount of sun available to them all around the year. And the third area, major area where we need to focus, and now it has become more dominant, that is health. We have to fight corona, we have to fight COVID, and so we have to work together. The science and technology community has to work together so that we can definitely come up with certain ideas. And we can today proudly say that India is the country which has brought up the most economic and most viable and feasible 2 vaccines for corona. And another 2-3 vaccines are in the pipeline, including the pediatric vaccines also. Fourth one is the agriculture part. The agriculture, in yesterday budget, we have already seen that government has raised another foot towards, you know, making agriculture more sustainable and for the overall holistic development of the agriculture field. And finally, the biodiversity is the final thing which actually needs to be taken care for the sustainable development. So overall, we can say that the goal or the aim to move the country towards more sustainable ideas, sustainable achievements is one primary focus, and the people from science and technology can contribute a lot for achieving this goal. So once again, I would welcome all, and I would request our first speaker, Dr. Jagdish Arora, Advisor, National Board of Accreditation, New Delhi, to please grace the occasion with his words of wisdom. Dr. Arora, sir, please, sir. I suppose Dr. Arora is connected with us.
I can. Yes, sir. He is here in the panelist right now.
Dr. Arora, are we audible to you? Yeah.
Okay, just a minute.
Okay.
Yeah.
Am I audible now? Yeah. Actually, I can see the presentation is already on. Hello. Yeah.
Hello, sir. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning, sir. So I'll be making a presentation on ranking of higher education in India. I'm associated with the National Institution Ranking Framework. As a director of Implement Center, we've been collaborating with National Board of Accreditation and bringing out this India ranking from past 5 years. So I'll be making a presentation on it. So the next slide, please. Namrata, you got my slides?
Yes, wait a minute, sir. Shrikant, sir, please play the presentation of Jagdish Arora, sir. I have just mailed you.
Okay, so to begin with, India ranking, we started in 2015. The first ranking came in 2016. And the basic idea was that we should somehow, you know, ask our institution to join international ranking and try to do better in it. So we thought this could work as a stimuli for Indian institutions to rank better in the world ranking. The criteria that we had selected were, most of them are used by international rankings also. For example, ranking by QS, ranking by THE, AIW, all of those criteria are quite common, but we also have some India-specific criteria that we have used for ranking. And hello. Can you run my presentation now?
Namrata ma'am, can we ask the technical team to run the presentation?
Yes, sir. Just wait a minute. They are playing it. Just wait a minute, sir.
Okay.
So if you look at the ranking, basically it is a very convenient and easily understandable method of evaluation and assessment. It's an ordinal number that is assigned to an institution based on certain criteria or parameters that are decided for ranking. And basically ranking, okay, so let's go to the next slide, please. Yeah, next slide, please.
Technical team, please go to the next slide.
So rankings are criticized and, of course, lauded for various reasons. For example, rankings are lauded for the role that they play in terms of this is the first slide. You can go to the next slide, please. So ranking is lauded and criticized simultaneously. They're lauded for serving an information tool for students, researchers, funding agencies, policy makers, and other stakeholders, as well as for instilling a competitive spirit among institutions that participate. And of course, they are criticized for the methodology used, for choices of indicators and weightage assigned to them, focuses on science and technology, and English languages, and assessment of institution as a whole instead of assessing an institution at program level. So let's go to the next slide, please. So if you look at the historical background, next slide, please. Next slide.
Shrikant, sir, kindly.
Yeah. If you look at the historical background, the first attempt towards ranking of academic institution can be traced back to 1870s, when U.S. Bureau of Education, writing their annual report, classified university based on the data that they had on universities. It is commonly believed that the ranking gained mass appeal in 1983, when U.S. News, so publications in U.S., basically a newspaper, they started ranking undergraduate program based on multidimensional methodology and survey-based. Basically, they surveyed university presidents and bring out the first ranking in 1983. 1987, they started using multidimensional methodology that we use now. Basically, more criteria than just the survey or perception. The first international meeting of ranking system was held in 2002 in Warsaw, Poland, wherein necessity of designing a conceptual framework and transparent methodology was first discussed. The International Ranking Expert Group, IREG, was formed in 2004, which was later transformed into IREG Observatory. So it works like an observatory, looks at the ranking that are there and the criteria that they use. And they, of course, give some kind of certification out. The next slide, please. So if you look at the, you know, the significant landmark in 2003, the first ranking called Academic Ranking of World University of Shanghai ranking appeared in 2003, followed by THE QS ranking. The THE and QS first brought out their ranking together. Later they created a set of principles of quality and good practices of HEI called Berlin Principles of Ranking were established and in 2002. These principles defined a framework for the innovation and dissemination of ranking, whether they are national, regional, global, in scope, and provide for continuous improvement and refinement in ranking. Ranking tables are also called league tables. As you know, league tables. In fact, league universities are about 8 universities in USA that are known for their academic excellence, selectivity in admissions, and high social status. So these 8 universities in US called league university include Brown University, Columbia University, Cornell University, Dartmouth College, Harvard University, University of Pennsylvania, Princeton University, and Yale University. Next, please. Next slide, please. So why do we rank university? Basically, the ranking of universities serve as a guide to students for selection of university. It helps universities to improve their own research performance and the quality, basically the criteria that are used for ranking. It helps the university to identify areas for improvement and to become better at educating students and conducting research. They help industry to look at the right universities and select programs that they want to hire from and provide a stable formula and framework for ranking, evaluation, and assessment of university. And of course, it instills a competitive edge among university and to achieve higher ranks at national and global ranking. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. So if you look at the major global initiatives, I'm listing 9 of them.
Rikanji, Turkey.
Next slide, please. So I'm listing these 9 rankings. Shanghai ranking is one of them, academic ranking of World University, THE Times Higher Education, QS World University Ranking, and US News. These are the 4 rankings that use multidimensional. Although there are 19 international rankings and 31 national rankings in about 50 rankings in, put together. Then you have this bibliometric ranking, which are based specifically on citation, highly cited publication, H index, and other things. Basically, bibliometric parameter, SciMago institution ranking, Leiden University ranking, Webometrics, and NTU. These are the 4. Of course, there is one Round World University, RUR, Round World University ranking, which basically I've listed that in between because 75%. Of the criteria are based on citations and publication, and about 25% on perception and other. So I've ranked them in between. I'll be describing only 3 rankings here. One is AIWU, QS, and THE. because of the fact that these three rankings are considered as big three of rankings, and others are not that important. So I will just be concentrating on these three rankings. Next, please. So as far as ARWU is concerned, it is one of the ranking that uses publicly available data. In fact, 90% of the data is on publications, citations, and other, you know, they have like, they've taken Nature and Science, article published in Nature and Science and others. And remaining 10% is only on Nobel Prizes and field medals. It's basically open source, depends on the open source information that is available. And it is basically lauded for its transparencies and the methodology that they use, which is very objective, stable, and transparent. ARWU is often criticized for size-dependent parameters that benefit larger institutions. It is biased towards science and technology and larger weightage publication and citation. More than, in fact, it is more than 90%, and remaining 10% is on field medals or on Nobel Prizes. It is brought up by China. So it is said that it takes into consideration the interest of the buyers of education. Unlike THE and QS, which is brought out from London, and they basically takes care of university, attracting students to the university. So let's go to the next slide, please. This slide basically shows how, what are the weightage that they give to various components. Like I mentioned, 10% goes to the, you know, Nobel Prizes, to anybody, and then staff winning Nobel Prizes, 20%. The research impact, highly cited papers, papers published in Nature and Science, paper indexed in Science Citation Index and Social Science Citation Index, and per capita academic performance of an institution, 10%. So this is how it is distributed. So what you can see is that 90% would favor the larger institutions. Only 10% goes for the per capita that balances things. So next slide, please. So you can see that 70% goes to research articles and citation, and 20% for awards, and in fact, 10% for per capita. Caption is wrong. Next, please. So there's a criteria about Nobel Prize. What is really puts you a bit wondering as to, you know, they gave criteria for, I mean, Albert Einstein was a, who worked at Free University, was given the points in 2003 ranking for Nobel Prize that was won by Albert Einstein in 1940s. Then the Humboldt University contested. They said, no, when the Nobel Prize was given, the work that Nobel Prize work was carried out at Humboldt University. So in 2004, the weightage for the Nobel Prize of Albert Einstein was given to Humboldt University. So as a result, Humboldt University and you know, got higher rank, and Free University was dropped by 100 positions. In 2005, Shanghai ranking decided not to run either Humboldt University or Free University because there was a they could not resolve as to whom the Nobel Prize should belong. So then it is said the Nobel Prize does not necessarily reflect teaching excellence. You might have Nobel Prize, you might have several other medals, but does it mean that those who win prizes or awards are better teachers? That's not certain. Let's go to the next slide, please. Next slide, please. And now let's go to Times Higher Education University ranking. They'll rank about 1,000 top universities. This year they've ranked about 1,400 universities. So like I mentioned before, Times Higher Education and QS, they started the ranking together in 2004. From 2004 to 2009, they ranked it together. And in 2010, they split it. THT signed up with Thomson Reuters for bringing out a new ranking. And QS used the methodology that was developed. They owned the methodology. And they started ranking their own. They brought out their own. Now, in 2014, THT signed up with Elsevier Science instead of with Web of Science. And they started using Scopus for compilation of rank. THE is often criticized for undermining non-science, non-English instruction institutions, and for relying heavily on subjective reputation survey. They assign almost 33% to reputation survey, which is biased towards institutions in Europe and America. THE is designed in UK, where the emphasis is to attract students to universities in Western world. As such, THE targets universities and economy of countries in Western world, whereas ARWU, like I mentioned, targets students, the interest of the interest. The current publications product of PhD includes world overall ranking, global subject ranking, reputation ranking, regional league tables for Asia, Latin America, BRICS, and ranking of institutions in emerging economies of the world. So this was a PhD. Let's move on to the next slide that describes QS ranking. So of course, this is the slide that shows how they've distributed the weightage given to various criteria. I would not elaborate on it. That is widely available. And I would also request organizer to make this slide available to participants. So instead of wasting on time, I'll go to the next slide. So as I mentioned, 37% goes to research articles, 33% to reputation survey, and remaining to other criteria. Next. Now, this is QS ranking. Like I mentioned before, QS and THE, they started ranking together in 2010, they separated. And QS used the ranking, the original methodology that was developed, where there is a lot of emphasis on reputation survey. Reputation survey carries 50%, which is considered as highly subjective criteria for evaluation and assessment. It is known for inconsistency and integrity of data use. It is observed that the QS sources its data from the websites of universities if it is not given by the university directly. And that such data could be really misleading. So their current publication includes world overall ranking, top universities in UK, top university in Australia, top universities in emerging Europe and Central Asia, and top universities in US. Next slide. The next slide shows the weightage assigned to different criteria. Like you can say that 50% goes to the survey, and remaining to student faculty ratio, international staff, international students, a lot of emphasis on internalization of education, and 20% to citation. Next, so 50% for public perception, 20% for research publication, and remaining for international, internationalization of education. Next. This slide shows how India or Indian higher education institution has performed in global university ranking. You can see that the number of institution or number of universities ranked by these rankings have increased drastically from say about 100 in the beginning or 500 in the beginning to about 1400 in case of THE. And likewise, Indian institutions are also ranked increasingly. One can say THE is the latest addition. They have ranked 56 institutions, Leiden 36, QS 24, ARWU, which is Shanghai University, Shanghai ranking, it list ranks about 15 institutions. RUR, which is Round University ranking, 13 institutions are ranked. And Webometrics in first 1,000, about 10 Indian institutions are ranked. So, of course, the number are increasing. But what is something worrisome is that they have not been able to retain the rank that they had. So ranks are actually falling, Padambar Sarikri. Next slide, please. So if you look at the World University ranking and the limitation that they have, one of the serious limitations is that we are talking of ranking about 1,000 universities in the world, where about 18,000 universities exist. So the global university ranking cannot justify national ranking system. So you do have to have a national ranking system. And of course, there are parameters which are country specific, like in our country, reservations, the downtrodden, the people belonging to lower caste, lower income group, need to have a special emphasis. So that is something that can be done by national ranking only. And some of the indicators that they use are very, you know, like for example, Nobel Prize. India do not have any Nobel Prize winner except for the Raman, where the weightage may not be available now. Of course, internationalization by nature, like for, we are not able to employ international faculty by law. Law doesn't permit, unless, of course, specific permission are sought. We don't have that kind of rules available. So, of course, World University Ranking have limitations, serious limitations. The reputation and perception-based evaluation used by QS and TG can be highly subjective and biased towards famous universities in Western world. Like, for example, if you, if you are asked to rank university, maybe Harvard and Stanford would come first to your mind, then maybe our own IITs. So that's what is called halo effect. People have that halo effect. So next slide, please. Now I'll come to ranking of education institution in India. Of course, if you look at the ranking history in India, you would find India Today, Business Today, all these media publications would bring out ranking, mostly in technologies, management, pharmacy, basically professional courses, rankings were available. So of course, in Wikipedia, there is an article that describes ranking that are available. Career 360 is a website that lists, of course, they give their ranking in top MBA college, engineering colleges, medical colleges, top colleges. InfliNet brought out a ranking of Indian universities using bibliometric parameters 2013. The exercise was not continued because we joined National Institute Ranking Framework, NIRF, and started contributing to Indian rankings. Next slide. So next slide, please. So the framework, National Institution Ranking Framework, was launched in 2015, September. It was launched by the then Honorable Minister of Human Resource Development. The framework outlines a methodology to rank institutions across the country on 5 broad parameters for various, you know, domains. So there are categories like universities, colleges, and overall. And there are domains like, you know, medical sciences and engineering and pharmacy and all of this. About 7 domains are ranked now. And the parameters that are used are teaching, learning and resources, research and professional practices, graduation outcomes, outreach and inclusivity, and perception. Next. This slide shows the weightage assigned to various parameters. Out of, if you, at a scale of 1, 0.30 is assigned to teaching and learning, 0.30 is assigned to research and professional practice, which is basically publication, citation, patent, highly cited publication, etc. 0.20 to graduation outcome, 0.10 to outreach and inclusivity, and 0.10 to perception. Let's go into further details. The next slide, please. So each of these 5 parameters have sub parameters. For teaching, learning, and resources, there's a parameter on student strength, faculty student ratio, faculty with PhD, and financial resources, and its utilization. Basically, it means that how much per capita a university spends on a student. Research and professional practices, like I mentioned, publication, citation, highly cited publication, patents, and project, basically research funds. The graduation outcome, it consists of four parameters, sub-parameters, placement and higher studies, university examinations, median salary given to students, and number of PhD students that are graduated. The outcome and inclusivity have four criteria, again, rather three criteria: regional diversity, women diversity, economically and socially challenged students, and lastly, perception have two parameters, employers and academic peers perception. Only two. We had a public perception also, but then it was discontinued because we could see that it is being misused or manipulated. Next, please. So now, if you look at the total number of people who applied to the ranking, it amounts to almost 5,000. So 5,000 institutions who apply to various categories give us a lot of data, which is not reflected in ranking. But then we analyzed that data, and then we came, you know, across some interesting insight that I would share with you. Well, next slide, please. So if you look at the faculty, this is for engineering. Faculty with PhD is 36.1% in engineering, and faculty with master's degree is 63.88%. So there are a lot of people who just have master's degree, but are teaching in colleges. Next. So now look at the experience. So people with 8-year experience, 41%. Between 8 to 15 years, 30.92%. Faculty with more than 15 years of experience is only 27%. So you can say there is much more younger faculty, less experienced faculty involved in teaching. Next. So this again, comparison between young versus experienced faculty. So institutions having 50% faculty with 8 years of experience, about 37.4%. Institutions having 50% faculty with more than 15 years of experience, only 8.14%. And remaining institution that we haven't classified. So you can see there are a lot of inexperienced faculty that are teaching in colleges and university. This again is for engineering, basically. Next, please. Now, what is interesting is that faculty with PhD is increasing. It's increased from 28% in 2017 to 36% in 2020. So trend is good. The qualified people are increasing, whereas faculty with master's degree have decreased from 72% to 64%. Next. Now, this data is for experience of faculty, like I mentioned. Again, there is an encouraging trend. Like faculty with 8-year experience is decreased from 54% to 41%. Faculty with 8 to 15 years experience has increased from 24.57% to 30.92%. And faculty with more than 15 years of experience has also increased from 21.27% to 27.82% in 2020. So 4 years, one can see that there's an encouraging reflections that people with better qualifications or rather better experience are increasing in colleges. Next slide, please. This is, of course, a graphical representation of the same data. Next, please. Again, graphical representation of data that I've already shown in the table format. Next. Now, this is faculty-student ratio. As you know, that about 20 students per class or 20 students per faculty is considered ideal. So one can see that there are larger number of institutions qualified for 21 to 30 ratio. Then, of course, 31 faculty, 31 to 40 per faculty, or 41 to 50, that was also there, but gradually it is increased. In the next slide shows how it is increased year-wise. Next, please. The next, you can see that faculty between 21 to 30 has increased from 350 to 515. So the trend shows, and whereas the faculty with larger FSR is decreasing, you know, every year. There's a good trend. It qualifies people for better marks in ranking. It qualifies people for approval process in AICT, and people trying to maintain. Next, please. Next slide, please. So this is median utilization of finance resources for different categories of discipline. So how much an institute spent per student, that is the data. You can say that in 2020, management discipline, you know, spends maximum of 81,000 per student, whereas other are a bit less. So of course, professional courses, just another 50. Next, please. Yeah, so this data is basically on publication. You can see that of top 100 institutions, 70% is publication is by top 100 institutions, and remaining is only 30%. So you can see column 6 and 7, while top 100 institutions provide the maximum, it's 89.15% in management and only 10.85% in case of remaining institutions. So you can see the same proportion almost in all categories. So you can say the top 100 universities are contributing to that. Next. So this is the same thing that is being shown graphically. You can see 90% is contributed by first 100 institutions, and remaining institute contribute only, you know, between 11 to 30%. Of course, college is exception. College, you can see that the top 100 contributes only 43% and remaining 57%. Next, please. So this is a research publication comparing, you know, various years. What one can see is the trend is that while top 100 institutions, the publication ratio is decreasing, whereas for remaining institutions, publication ratio is increasing year by year. It's a very interesting trend, which basically means that remaining institutions are also making efforts to show better publication. Next. This is for highly cited publication. Like I mentioned, in case of publication, 70% comes from top 100 and remaining 30% from remaining. Here, highly cited publication, the same trend. In fact, it is much more, almost 92.64% in management, 80% in case of universities, 91% in case of 75. So top 100 contribute the most, and remaining 20% or less than that. Next. So the same figure in the graphical part. Okay, this again is shown year-wise, in different years. Again, the same tendencies that first 100, the ratio is decreasing, whereas for the remaining 20%, remaining institution, it is increasing. Next. This slide shows as to how institution, how the data for NIRF institutions compare with rest of India and world. One can see that almost 65 to 70%, rather 83% in engineering is contributed by India Ranking Institution. So, I mean, one can say that almost 80% or rather more than 80% institutions who produce article are already participating in institution in India Ranking exercise. Remaining institution may include research institution who do not have, teaching activity. And the data, if you compare with the world, is also quite typical, especially in engineering, it is 6.62%, pharmacy 5.52%, and of course, management, it is much lesser, 3.2%. Next slide. So this is yearly comparison of the data publication of eligible institution in comparison to total research publication of India. One can see that the percentage of NIRF eligible institution is increasing every year. The increased place, let's say in case of engineering, from 67.84% in 1927 to 83.144%. So this again is increasing every year. Next, please. And the same figure shown vectorially as to how there is an increase in various categories. Next. Now, what is surprising is that there are universities that have zero publications. They are applicant to India Ranking and they have zero publication. So you can say in overall category 7.54%, in university category 0.37%. And of course, management, it is highest, 63.56%. Next. The same slide shown in vectorially. Next, please. And now this slide shows share of India's total publication versus publication of NIRF applicant institution. One can see that in engineering, 83.44% are from NIRF eligible institution. Only 16.56 is not from NIRF publication. This may include institutions that are not applicant. This may include institutions that are research laboratories like CSIR or ISRO and other similar organizations. Next. So this slide shows increase in number of publication over the year from NIRF eligible applicant institution. One can observe drastic increase in publication. Next. So this is pictorial diagram of the same data. Next. Next, please. Now this is comparative research publication of World, India and NIRF applicant in overall categories. You can see that over the year, there's an increase in publication and NIRF publication keep increasing every year. Increased from 1,78,000 to about 3,00,000 publication in 2020. Next. So this is shown pictorially as to how they've increased over the year from 67% to 70%. And for remaining, for other institution, it has decreased from 32% to 29%. Next. Now, this is a very interesting graph. It shows correlation between ranking done only on research parameters and ranking done using all the criteria. You can see that correlation coefficient is very strong. And for engineering is 86. And for colleges, of course, it's lower, 0.41. But what the message that it conveys, if you are good at research publication, your ranking is going to be. It doesn't matter how other parameters measure up. Next. This is correlation coefficient between rankings in various disciplines. So you can see that 2017 to 2020, the correlation is very strong, especially management, in overall, in all the categories, the correlation is positive and very strong. It basically means that same sets of institutions are doing well, and they keep appearing year after year in India. This conveys the message that the methodology used is strong. And so next slide, please. This pictorial diagram of the same things. Next. 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 So this is regional distribution of rank distributions in 2020. This is for engineering, how institutions were distributed across various geographical regions. One can see, of course, the South has the most representation, 41%, and remaining 24% North, 16% West, and 19% East. Next. So if you look at the, what is the role that librarian can play, the librarians are involved in publication, citation analysis, presentation, and these are the activities that implemented library science qualified people are involved. Librarians should take responsibility for coordinating activities relating to ranking, evaluation, and assessment. In fact, several of our nodal officers in India rankings are librarians. Of course, they should run information literacy program on what is impact factor, H-index, I-10 index, I-20 index, high-impact journals, predatory journals, predatory conferences. So these kind of information literacy need to be imparted by the librarian. They should master art of searching citation databases, patent databases, plagiarism detection, and related resources. And they should organize workshops, seminars, and webinars to educate the students, faculty, and of course, technical writing is a field where librarians can contribute the most. They can participate or they can coordinate with publishers and organize such programs. So lastly, I'll mention OCLC perception of libraries, where they've mentioned that wherever the libraries were involved in evaluation and assessment process, that institutions have done very well. And of course, institution repository is one of the fields where the librarian contributes the most. With that, I finish my talk. It was a pleasure interacting with you. I'm sorry for the technical problem that we had our end.
Hope it was a pleasure listening to you, sir.
Thank you.
And it was really very learning approach for all of us, that we could get an insight about all the different type of rankings. And our university, Sri Vaishno Vidyapeeth Vishwavidyalaya, has also been participating in the NIRF ranking since last 3 years. And although we have not been able to secure any position in first 100 till now, but we are hopeful that by improving on the parameters which you have just mentioned in your whole presentation, we will definitely be securing a position. So once again, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah. With this, we come to the second speaker of today's plenary session. I would like to request and invite Dr. Shailesh Mohite to please deliver his talk for today's plenary session. Dr. Mohite, sir.
Thank you, sir. Very good morning to all of you.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
At the outset, I thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to interact with all of you. Yesterday was our budget, and the budget, keeping in line with your goals of sustainable development, the finance minister has provided 64,000 crores for the upliftment of healthcare industry in our country, out of which, as we said, as time has passed, we have come across new diseases. And with new diseases, the latest which we are facing is COVID-19. And to overcome the deaths and minimize the sufferings of the individuals, we have a vaccination program where many trials are going on, and two vaccines are presently being given to individuals. And the government has kept aside 34,000 crore budget only for vaccination. Being the medical superintendent of Nair Hospital, I am aware about both the programs. Nair Hospital was a totally dedicated COVID hospital in the city with a strength of 1043 beds, which was almost always full to capacity. So I have seen this very closely. I come from forensic medicine, so I will be speaking basically of role of forensic medicine. What is the scenario that has changed in today's world with forensic medicine and the medical education? Also, what is the liaison or handholding of forensic medicine with forensic sciences and how it can be utilized for humanity? That will be my topic of talk. Till recently, till last year, we had the Medical Council of India. Now we have the NMC, that is the National Medical Commission. And there is a vast difference between the curriculum in the previous years and now. Keeping in mind good practices and making a good medical graduate for this country, there has been a change in curriculum and we have now shifted to CBME, competency-based medical education. So it is not basically theoretical, but person should be competent enough as a fresh medical graduate to handle any situation, be it disease to disaster, anything. So in this way, how we are going to do, the role of telemedicine, which plays an important role, at least in state of Maharashtra, most of the government medical colleges have got telemedicine centers. I come from Mumbai, so we have a robust healthcare system where we run 4 medical colleges, a dental college, apart from which we have got 5 specialty hospitals and 16 peripheral hospitals. What happens that though the population has increased vastly, the healthcare facilities needs to be further strengthened. And though we have got 4 medical colleges, most of the drainage comes towards these tertiary colleges. The cities have expanded on the periphery and the colleges have remained concentrated in the center. So there is lots of traveling. In Mumbai, traveling is an issue. To have good practices and to ease difficulties for people, we are now in a process of strengthening our 16 peripheral colleges through development of DNB courses, where these doctors would be available to the general population. Through telemedicine, they can interact in the city also with tertiary care medical college people and gain whatever difficulties they have, the problems and the solutions for their problems. Apart from that, cases can be shared, research can be done. It could be a combined research. So these things need to be kept in mind for them. Now, I request madam to please put on my presentation.
Shrikant sir, kindly do the needful, please.
If we see today's headlines in Maharashtra, probably in many parts of the country, this might have gone. We had a pulse polio on 31st and instead of giving pulse polio vaccine, 12 children in district of Yavatmal, they were given sanitizer by mistake. So if you have practices, you have SOPs in place, these things can certainly be avoided. At places we get fires. We had a fire in last month in one of the hospitals in Maharashtra where 8 to 9 kids lost their lives. So good practices, SOPs form the basis of good services. And if we have good services, we can become a developed country.
The technical team is requested to please play the presentation.
Yes, I chose the topic utility of forensic medicine to the society because when it comes to forensic medicine or postmortems, it is usually understood by the common public that forensic medicine means only related to death. So wanted to just share our views and our contribution towards the society. Next slide, please. Next. So as our subject, forensic medicine, as we've got various synonyms like legal medicine, state medicine, etc. The term forensic was basically derived from the Latin term forum, which meant a marketplace where justice was dispensed in older times. We have two terminologies. One is forensic medicine and second is medical jurisprudence. In forensic medicine, we apply our medical knowledge as medical graduates for practice of law and medical jurisprudence, where juris means law and prudentia is knowledge. It means the knowledge of law a doctor should have during his practice of medicine. He should practice in line with the laws laid down by the state. Today's newspaper, if you see, the government has come with a new Nursing Home Act. And with this Nursing Home Act, in today's times of India in Maharashtra, it says how difficult it will be now for the doctors to abide by those laws which have been given in the Nursing Home Act. And these nursing homes will be slowly a dying out facility. Next. So here I've said what is medical jurisprudence, jurists' law, prudential knowledge. So what does it comprise? It doesn't comprise only knowledge of law, but it comprises of knowledge of law between certain people. One is between the doctor and patient, the relationship which he develops, the doctor and doctor relationship, and most importantly, the doctor and state relationship, where the state has entrusted upon the doctor certain compulsory duties, certain voluntary duties. It contains also, what do you mean by medical ethics and etiquette? These are also covered. Next. Forensic pathology, as the term is used abroad, not in our country. So that means to study the problems relating to certain suspicious, unnatural deaths. In India, we do not call it forensic pathology, but we call it as forensic medicine. Toxicology forms an important part of a medical doctor's curriculum because at least there are about 20 to 25% cases of poisoning which a medical graduate deals. So what is toxicology? In one line, if I have to tell you, it is a science that deals with poisons. But what in poison? So right from where the poison is formed, its nature, source, characters, properties, the signs, symptoms it produces, the fatal dose, fatal period. What are the methods of investigations? What are the newer methods of investigation that have come up? Previously, minute quantities was difficult to detect. Now with advancement of forensic sciences, even very minute quantities can be detected. The viscera, which was to be sent in large quantity, now can be sent in lesser quantity. And after some days also, these poisons can be detected. This forms one part of the definition. The second part of the definition is, it also deals with laws relating to distribution, possession, sale of poisons. And these poisons include narcotics also. And after the Sushant Singh death, we have Narcotic Control Bureau coming into play, and we have seen so many arrests of possession, distribution, sale of poisons. So toxicology, we need to understand what is the poison sample to be preserved. Now, where previously forensic medicine people were just looking after cases of poisoning, have now divulged themselves into certain newer areas, like having a poison information center in the hospital, whereby they cater to the district, give expert opinion in poisoning cases. Many of the departments have got a toxicology laboratory where they accept samples of gastric lavage, blood, urine, and also detect them and give a report with the help of a scientist attached to their lab. Next, please. Not only postmortem cases, we deal with a huge number of antemortem cases also. What are the antemortem cases? We relate to age estimation, examination of injured, examination of victims of sexual assault, examination of potency, paternity cases, child abuse cases. I will come to you in detail about age estimation, but here, while speaking about examination of potency, now this comes under a specialized team where you require a urologist along with you or an endocrinologist. But being few in number, these super specialists, there are certain difficulties in cases of potency. Next. We deal with postmortem cases, not the routine medico-legal cases only. We have to handle cases of NHRC, National Human Rights Commission cases, which needs to be reported to them. Tertiary cares, we get referral cases from surrounding districts or surrounding postmortem centers. Being qualified people and a medical officer would not be that trained to do exhumation. It is dealt by Department of Forensic Medicine. At times, the autopsy might be conducted at a peripheral center where the relatives are not satisfied, related to or still after conducting a postmortem, they might have an allegation, feeling that the doctor has been biased. So in such cases, the cases are referred to tertiary care center. Examination of skeletal remains forms a huge, huge thing. Our city has seen cases, our country has seen cases like Nithari, where there was a huge bundle of bones and the task is humongous to identify the bones belonging to which person, and handing over to the right parent or the guardian is a huge thing because of the emotional factor attached to one's near and dear ones. Next. Apart from these cases, the other role a forensic expert plays, especially in tertiary care, is for organ donation. Whenever an autopsy has to be done on a body where the relatives have pledged eye donation or organ donation, the doctor who is going to conduct autopsy, his role is from giving consent to being present in the hospital where the organ donation takes place, conduct the autopsy at the same place, perform a medical audit of everything. In cases of homicides or serious assault cases, weapons would be brought to us for examination, whether the injuries can be caused by the weapon in the alleged manner as it is said. So here it is not only the weapon, but to collect proper evidences, meaning sharpness. Apart from that, any stains which are present, to collect those stains, match with those of the accused or the victim person. Examination of specimens like snakes. This is more common in the rural area, where there are snake bites and the relatives would often get the snake. So this forms another important part of training of our undergraduates to identify the snakes or other poisonous insects, etc., so that immediate and right in treatment can be instituted and human life can be saved for it. Expert opinion, either referred from investigating agencies or at times police might call you as an expert, us as an expert witness, and take down the evidences in court. Certification of deaths, research, a very, very vital part in a doctor's life, especially in a medical college, because based on research, newer things come forth. undergraduate and postgraduate teaching. And just as I said, we have since last year a new curriculum where it is now competency-based. Most of the institutes are going to have skill laboratories where mannequins would be used for showing certain procedures to the student. They would be giving hands-on training. University and Medical Council of India related work. These are the other work that a doctor has to perform. So a forensic expert's role is a very vast one and not just limited to postmortems as it is taught. Next, please. So in our country also, slowly, slowly, our subject is getting broken down into various subspecialties. Just as initially we had medicine, then from medicine, we got super specialty courses like neurology, nephrology, cardiology, etc. Our surgical branches were further developed into neurosurgery, cardiac surgery, etc. Here also now with initial situation in our country, there were very few takers for post-graduation in forensic medicine, but the younger lot is now started to come in. And we are also now diversifying into various other things like forensic thanatology, forensic psychiatry, forensic ballistics, odontology, etc. Next, please. What is a medico-legal case? Forensic medicine basically deals with medico-legal case. Can a medico-legal case be registered at the beginning or at the end? These are some of the questions that cross a common man's mind and also a doctor's mind. So medico-legal case, in short to tell you, is any case where a legal or an investigative intervention is required. So any case of injury or ailment. Ailment is a disease process where the attending doctor, after history taking and clinical examination, considers that the investigation by law enforcement agencies are warranted to certain circumstances and fix the responsibility regarding the said injury or ailment according to law. So, a person might be admitted at the very beginning. He might not suffer anything. It is a natural course of events. But in the event of the death, and the bills are huge, many a time the relatives at the end would put an allegation of negligence. So, a case which was a non-MLC now becomes a MLC and the police start investigating. These are some of the examples of what I mean by medico-legal cases. So cases of assault, accidents, cases of trauma with foul play, burns, scald, sexual violence cases or sexual offenses like POXO, sexual assault, PETA, criminal abortions, poisoning, custody deaths, operation theater deaths, undiagnosed within 24 hours of admission, and admitted attempted suicide. These are some of the examples of medico-legal cases. The list is not complete. And as I said, in any case where a legal or an investigative intervention would be required, would become a medico-legal case. So a case which is initially a non-MLC can become an MLC at any stage. Next, please. Important duties in medico-legal cases to give justice to an individual is, at the initial stage, one need to inform the police immediately about the case. But if he is the lone doctor, his first priority would be to save the life of the patient. So he could do the same and tell someone to pass on the information till then, or he might attend to the patient, stabilize him, and then subsequently inform the police. After taking consent, examination of the patient and giving treatment, one needs to complete all the medico-legal formalities and issue a medico-legal certificate as early as possible. Today morning I read on one of the forums that High Courts of Punjab and Haryana, they have directed the health authorities of that state that there should not be any undue delay in giving reports in medico-legal cases or all medical cases. They have cited one case where bail was given to an individual. And after 5 months, when the report came forth, the case was of a very serious nature, and therefore the person was already on bail. So to avoid such things, High Court of Punjab and Haryana and the Union Territories have been, health authorities have been directed to see that there is no undue delay in giving reports. Issue medical legal report in serious cases after emergency management, arrange for recording of dying declaration. Very important. If the doctor feels that the person is going to die, even before police would come, then he himself can record the dying declaration. If the person becomes unconscious, he can put his signature and signature of two witnesses and close the dying declaration and hand over to police when they come forth. The role of the doctor while giving such or while recording of such dying declaration when police comes is he has to say whether the person is in compos mentis, and that is in a sound, stable state of mind to give statement or otherwise. And secondly, is at the end of the evidence dying declaration, again, he has to certify the same. He needs to write down certain things as to who is taking the dying declaration, in which language, at what time he has begun and what time it ends. Because this dying declaration forms a very important part in the event of death of a person, okay? In case of death of a person, therefore, the doctor should be very vigilant. He would be asked whether he was present at the time of dying declaration or otherwise. Do not accept the request by persons accompanying not to register and medico-legal case. This is the common thing where people say, please do not register a medico-legal case. If the doctor does not register a medico-legal case, then he would be at fault. He might be held as an accessory to crime. So one has to use his own experience and judgment. Next, please. Confidentiality must be maintained in all cases and must be kept secret about all information regarding the patient and that one comes across during the course of examination. Medico-legal reports should be handed over to the authorized police official only after getting them duly received on the carbon copy of the same. We would receive lots of RTIs for information about the patient. So patient's consent or next of the kin's consent is very essential. If the patient or in the event of his death, his next of kin asked for any case papers, etc., it is mandatory for the hospital to provide the same free of charge within 72 hours. Next, please. Come to postmortem. So what is postmortem? So it is a special type of scientific examination carried out under the laws of the state, that is under 174 or 176 of the CRPC, for protection of its citizens and to assist the identification and prosecution of the guilty. Next, please. So many a times people feel that only finding out the cause of death is the purpose or aims and objective of the autopsy. But as I run through the list, you will see that it is a very exhaustive list for which autopsy is done. First and foremost, in case of unknown individuals, to first is establish the identity. The moment one establishes the identity, it becomes much easier for the investigating officer to find out who the person is, with whom he could have had a tiff, and who could have bumped him off, etc., or the motive for it. As everyone knows, to find out the cause of death, the nature of death, natural, unnatural, suicidal, homicidal, accidental. Estimate time since death, which also becomes very important factor in apprehension of the offender or linking the offender with the crime, to ascertain whether the death is due to one or multiple injuries, whether the injuries are antemortem or postmortem in nature. Next. Is the injury sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause death, or whether it is likely to cause death? What do I mean in sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause death? is suppose in a train accident, if the head has been totally separated out from the trunk, it is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause death. Whereas a stab injury on the abdomen may cause death if not treated in time. If the injury is present on the body, or whether they are self-inflicted or due to defense injuries. From the position of the injuries and direction of the injuries, one would also find out the relative position of the victim and assailant at the time of offense. From the different patterns of injury, say some are incise wounds, some are stab wounds, some are bruises because of, say, a hockey stick or a cycle chain, then one would draw a rough estimate as to the number of assailants that were present while assaulting. What do I mean by find place of death? Meaning whether this is the place of occurrence of death or the body has been brought from some other area and dumped over here. If the body has been brought from some other area and dumped over here, one needs to collect evidence present on the body from the mud, from the sole, or any other particles attached to the body. And subsequently, these can be matched with the crime scene, which is identified later. So this will help us, this type of physical evidence will go a great way in connecting the crime scene with the deceased person. Here the role of forensic sciences and forensic medicine comes, where the doctor would collect evidences and hand over to our forensic scientist, who would find out from the nature of the soil whether it is the same as found at the crime scene. Next, please. To collect and preserve evidence left on the victim's body by the accused person. So it could be the hair present on the hand, it could be blood stains, it could be broken nails, to pieces of small metal objects on the body from the broken thing. Newborn infants, if found dead, our purpose is whether the child was born alive or it was stillborn, whether viable or not viable. At times, every yearly at least we get 3 or 4 cases where an elderly person, say more than 70, 75 years of age, has a strong argument with someone, tempers boil on both sides, he just collapses and dies even without someone else touching him. At autopsy, we find that he might have sustained a heart attack, or because of an hypertension, there could be a bleed. In such cases, we need to find out what it is, whether there is a role of any pre-existing disease. And in cases of mutilated or skeletal remains, we need to find out the cause of death and time since death. Next, please. What are the requisites? Who can do an autopsy? Only a registered medical practitioner can do. And to give justice, what is important? That the examination should be complete in both positive as well as important negative findings. That is, if there is a forthcoming history that a person was assaulted with a rod on the head, but if I find that there are no fractures, there is no injury to the brain, this happens to be an important negative finding which I need to document. And important positive findings could be something else which could have caused the death. Whatever things in an MLC would have to be produced in court. So I need to produce good evidence in the form of written records, sketches, photographs, x-rays, proper collection and preservation of evidence. And I need to draw a factual and objective medical report on the basis of the history, my positive and negative findings, which I have recorded at autopsy, corroborated with all the investigations which I have sent. So this will form an objective medical report for the law enforcement agency. Next, please. While examining injuries, one needs to be aware as to what is the legal definition of an injury, hurt, or a mechanical injury. So these are just legal definitions. So 44 says that whatever harm caused to a person illegally in body, mind, reputation, or property. Now then, there is something called as legal injury which I can cause. So a surgeon in my hospital, when he does an operation, he takes a cut on the body of the person. So this is absolutely legal because this is done after taking a consent. But the same injury could be, same incision could become an injury if the consent is for one operation and some other operation has been performed. Next, please. So these are the various forms of injury. When I write an injury report, I should be aware as a doctor that the punishment for different injuries are different. So a simple injury, which is not grievous, but simple. And what is grievous had been 8 clauses have been enumerated in section 320 of the IPC, which are emasculation, permanent privation of sight of either eye, privation of hearing of either ear, etc. So these are the 8 clauses. So the punishment will vary according to whether it is simple, dangerous, or grievous injury. Next, please. So physical assault or injury, whenever a case comes, one needs to keep the case under observation, especially where there is a history of head injury. So one has to look for whether the patient had become unconscious after that. Was there any bleeding from the ear, nose, mouth? Was there any vomiting? All these are signs of head injury. If there are cuts, etc., whether the person is in a condition of shock. Otherwise, there could be simple suturing and he could be sent back. Or a CT scan taken and there is no bleeding, he might be sent back. We have seen cases where a person has been sent back after saying that there is nothing and patient has come after 4-5 hours and died. At autopsy, it is seen that there was intracranial hemorrhage. Therefore, there might not be hemorrhage at an early stage, but after a few hours, the hemorrhage might start because a small clot which was formed over there has got dislodged and the blood could accumulate. So one has to compulsorily admit, especially cases of head injury, for at least 24 hours before discharging them. Next, please. Now, what are the things while examining a case of injury one needs to look for? Is nature of injury, that is one which will look for age of injury, manner of causation, antemortem or postmortem, causative weapons, site of impact, direction of the injury, resulting disability, whether it is simple, and the factors modifying. These are the facts one would look for. Next, please. Burns cases, these are certain specific cases which I take into, is while noting down the nature of the burns commonly, or some of the tricky things which we need to learn is, are there any injuries on the palms and soles to see whether the person was conscious or unconscious when the burns were taken, were sustained, to prepare an exact factual report. Subsequently, common defenses put forth in cases of burns are, would there be pain after such extensive burns? The answer given by the doctor is yes. Were any painkillers given? Yes. Then the defense would say, would it alter the mind state of the person? These are types of questions that would be put forth in such cases. Next. In cases of poisoning, as we said, information to police after taking consent, record signs, symptoms. If serious, dying, declaration, collection of evidence. But as I said, poisoning cases, a single case and mass poisoning are different. Mass poisoning draws public attention, causes government attention, whereby mass food poisoning in a marriage ceremony or some other place or in a school where some meals are distributed to children, then there is a political mileage for this issue and one has to be very careful in collecting evidence to connecting it and also to saving lives of the individuals, preparing a report properly. Huge or liquor tragedies, which I personally have seen 3 during my career, where the number of cases which were much more appearance in court and establishment. So here the mid, more than the autopsy part, the record part is how you have preserved the samples, where they were preserved, basically the chain of evidence becomes an important thing. So a doctor should be aware, a forensic expert should be aware about when the samples were received in the lab, when they were analyzed, when the reports were sent, were the samples received by the forensic scientist in a proper manner, was the preservative proper, was the quantity of viscera provided sufficient enough to detect the poison and the levels. These are the things that would come. Next, please. Yeah. Sexual violence cases. We run a multidisciplinary child protection center since the year 1999, and the Act of POXO came in 2012. We have to collect evidences very carefully. Two purposes. One is, I would now in this case stick to what are the guidelines given. There is a specific pro forma given, so nothing is missed out now. Most important is consent. Now the consent would be merely for examination, merely for treatment or collection of samples. If the girl says no samples to be collected, we cannot force her. Samples in case of sexual violence to be, our forensic science laboratory has given guidelines that within 4 days, if the act has taken place, then you collect sample. This is for penetrative sexual assault. Now these samples are blood stains, semen, vaginal swabs, hair, nails, etc. to be collected, preserved and sent to FSL. The forensic science laboratory gives us a report that there is no semen detected. But these are the things which we need to integrate and put forth is, there is no mention about what type of cells they are seen. If it is a vaginal swab, are there any STDs seen? Is there any bacterial growth seen on it? It becomes very difficult to later on prove whether actually it was a vaginal swab, a swab from the nasal cavity or from the ear. So it is important that the forensic scientist also mentions what type of cells are there. So this can be proved in court. Yes, this is indeed a vaginal swab and not from some other body part. Based on this, the government of India has given a chart as to what exact opinion has to be given. Because the opinion framed in this cases of sexual violences was giving lots of discrepancies because the opinions are not formed properly. So now government has come out with guidelines. If physical injuries are present, if investigations are positive, if investigations are negative, nature of offense, how the opinion should be framed. So with the advent of all these new protocols, these ambiguity has gone away, and we have now got good practice for sexual violence cases where it becomes very easy for the judiciary also to understand and decide upon the case. Next, please. Age estimation. We have got cases, we almost deal with 85 to 90% cases in Mumbai city which come under Prevention of Immoral Trafficking Act, Sexual Assault, POXO. We have cases of sports persons for hiding the age. Though they are overage, they have produced a fake certificate showing to be underage. Lots of NGOs bring cases to us of small children who have to be given for adoption and there is no age proof. Retirement dispute cases, juvenile offenders in terrorist attack cases, or other criminal cases. So here also, lots of medical evidence goes and preservation. Lots of research has been done in this. Okay, so dental estimation is a very important aspect. At what age did the root calcify? All these things. Next, please. Types of cases this are received, and many forensic medicine departments handle in the casualty at places. The whole casualty is under Department of Forensic Medicine and deals with MLCs like broad dead, medical, surgical emergencies, traumas, sexual violence, etc. Next, please. Yes. In PETA cases, I will not repeat, we have already done this. Next, please. Yes. Now, specific amendments have come in rape cases. So the CRPC 2005 amendment says that there should not be any unnecessary delay and there should be examined immediately, samples sent immediately. Only in presence of a female, you should examine, noting down the time of beginning and ending and mandatory collection of these samples. Gone are those days when, as forensic experts or as doctors, we are looking towards the victim and merely collecting of specimens or collecting of evidences. Now we have shifted our focus from evidence collection to treatment and rehabilitation of the victim as well. So where previously the victim samples were collected and sent, now we are admitting the victim where there is a need. Because if she is psychologically broken down, she needs to be stabilized in the hospital. Her mental health becomes very, very important. If it is a street child, rehabilitation of the child, or if it is a child who has been abused by one of the family member, we cannot send back the child into the same house. So we need to liaison with various NGOs and find a fit place. If the father is the survivor in the family and he is the abuser, then we need to take help of an NGO. We need not only for care and protection, we need to produce the child in front of child welfare committee, but also we need to keep the child motivated till the last. So we need to provide with her with legal aid through certain NGOs, which will do the hand-holding till the last, and such offenders will be booked, whereby we can free our society or decrease such criminal activities in the society by setting up a good example. Next, please. Okay, so to assess the patient suffering in emergency and give appropriate treatment. So it might not be only for medical purposes. It could be because of public liability, personal injury claims, also cases on the job injury suffered would come to us. Next, please. A doctor needs to upgrade himself continuously. And one needs to be aware about what are the acts and day-to-day happening, the amendments that occurred. Just as I told you at the very beginning that today there is a amendment that has happened in the Nursing Home Act. So a doctor cannot say that I was not aware. Ignorance of law cannot be an excuse. So these are some of the common laws which a doctor needs to be aware is Human Organ Transplantation Act. Because many a times I have seen on WhatsApp, even doctors forwarding WhatsApp messages like 4 kidneys are available for transplantation. So this comes out of ignorance of the law. Medical Termination of Pregnancy Act, what are the amendments, what is PCPNDT Act, what is Consumer Protection Act, Mental Health, Juvenile Justice, ITPA, Domestic Violence Act. Not reporting of a crime is also an offense, therefore the doctor needs to be aware of it. Bombay Prohibition and Human Rights Act, next. Police, liaisoning. There are certain agencies which need to form a strong bond. And I have always spoken of agencies like the doctor, the police, and the judiciary. Unless and until they hold hands and form a strong chain whereby the accused cannot escape, then it will be a golden day in our country whereby we can book these people, reform them. So assisting the police in drawing factual conclusions by crime scene visits, conducting medico-legal examinations, giving opinion based on photographs many a times from rural area where the crime has taken place, or it is old cases. Now everyone has got a smartphone, so everyone records everything. But in old cases where there are a few photographs only, then and over the years, the quality of the photographs deteriorates. So one has to be very careful while giving opinion on it. So these documents need to be submitted in court training. While giving opinion, I need to keep in mind that I will have to stand cross-examination in court for this. Next, please. judiciary. Two important things. The judicial academies, they see to it that they train their judges very frequently. They have refresher courses. They are taught how to come to a conclusion. They should call experts, take down the evidences, etc. While giving evidence in court, which helps in administration of justice, I should understand that the judicial officer or the judge is not a medical person. So I have to simplify and put forth to him my evidences which I have, reply to whatever cross-examination I have, not to be shaken by any questions. It is not mandatory for me as a doctor to answer each and every question. That is what I should remember. If I'm not aware about anything, I should say so. Expert opinion in complicated cases, I need to give. And training of judges or judiciary is very important. I think I will stop over here. If there are any questions, I would be happy, because next is just preservation of Visra. So thank you, organizers, for giving me an opportunity. Dr. Kavita Sharma, thank you very much. Chairpersons, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you. And I would request the forum that if they have any questions, any of the participant or panelists, then please feel free. Kavita ma'am, it's over to you.
I think sir has discussed and explained everything very, very clearly. So I don't find any question in the chat box. So no questions means understood everything. So seriously, sir, बहुत ही अच्छे से आपने बताया. So I would like to thank Dr. Mohite. But before that, the first speaker was Dr. Jagdish Arora on the plenary session 2 of the Sanmantrana on good practices and capacity building for sustainable development goals. As sir is advisor of National Board of Accreditation, he threw light on the ranking institutions of higher education. It is to help the universities to identify areas of improvement and to become better at educating students and conducting research, as research plays key role in ranking of the universities. So I would like to mention here that Honorable Vice Chancellor of our university always emphasize on research. Our university is providing all of us full facility for the research, and he always motivate all of us and researchers of our university to do the good research with full research ethics. Sir also shared the credit for Nobel Prizes, the limitations of World University ranking system, and international ranking cannot reflect the state of national higher education systems, as they usually cover just the top universities of each country. And India itself has 900 plus universities. And sir also shared the data of young versus experienced faculties and student versus faculty ratio in higher education. So I don't find any question for the Jagdish Arora sir. So thank you, Jagdish Arora sir. Now I come to the next speaker, Dr. Shailesh Mohite. Started his talk on the budget sanction for the health sector. And he spoke on role of forensic medicine for achieving justice for general public, and focused on how forensic medicine and forensic science is sister concern. Sir very nicely experienced forensic medicine and its importance in antemortem and postmortem medical cases. He discussed toxicological aspects to find cause of death and importance of viscera and its preservation techniques to maintain chain of custody of toxicological exhibits with relevant pictures. He stressed on injury and its classification to find out age of wound to solve medical cases like burn, poisoning, and rape cases. That will be very much helpful for the students, particularly for the forensic science students. So he also threw light upon the role of a doctor in medico-legal cases very effectively. Forensic medicine widely expanding its footprint in forensic discipline, and its scope is increasing day by day to find out cause of death in medico-legal cases. So I would like to mention that forensic science plays a crucial role in global justice system and international capacity building. It supports investigations, demonstrates associations between people, places, and things involved in criminal activity, and exonerate the innocent. Forensic science is a public good that should be equally available to all, what Sir has discussed. By providing science to the criminal justice system, forensic science supports social and economic stability by enabling the role of law. As the UN mission statement detailed, all 17 goals out of around 8 was discussed by my friend Dr. Namit Gupta are intended to offer blueprint to achieve a better and more sustainable future for all by 2030. The goals recognize that improving health and education, reducing inequality, and spurring economic growth, which addressing climate change to preserve our oceans and forests, are key to a better world for all. According to the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development Goals, member states are committed to the promotion of democratic governance, where peace, security, and rules of law, protection of human rights, and inclusive societies, that is Sustainable Development Goal 16. Sir, presentation met with this goal, SDG 16, which is peace, justice, and strong institutions are essential for the sustainable development. I would like to mention that as university, we are also fulfilling our responsibility to achieve sustainable development goals. So sustainable development goal 16, that is peace, justice, and strong institutions, is an accelerator of all sustainable development goals, and it is very critical to achieving sustainable development as it has a very strong linkage with the remaining 16 sustainable development goals, what Dr. Mohite sir has already covered. So in the plenary session second, both the deliberations were very concise and informative. I am sure all the participants, students, and researchers are benefited after listening them. So at the end, I congratulate to all the us and Team Sanmantrana, especially Dr. Santosh Dhar, ma'am, chairperson of Sanmantrana. I would like to thank for giving me opportunity to share my views and to conclude the session. And I also thank to Dr. Namrita, Dr. Pragya, and Dr. Swapnil for the nice management of the session. Thank you, Dr. Mohite. Thank you. Thank you very much for delivering such a nice lecture. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I would like to propose the vote of thanks. So good afternoon, one and all. I would like to propose vote of thanks for the second plenary session of Sanvantarana 2021, a multidisciplinary international congress on good practices and capacity building for sustainable development goals. My earnest thanks to Dr. Jagdish Arora, Advisor, National Board of Accreditation, and Dr. Shailesh Mohinde, Professor and Head Forensic Medicine, Mumbai, for their enlightening sessions. I would like to thank Honorable Vice-Chancellor Sir Dr. Upendra Dhar Sri Vaishnav Vidyapeeth Vishwavidyalaya in Absentia for motivating, guiding, and providing a visionary path to all of us. I would like to thank Dr. Santosh Dhar Ma'am, Dean FDSR and Conference Convener, Sri Vaishnav Vidyapeeth Vishwavidyalaya for all the guidance and support. I would like to thank the Chairperson, Dr. Namit Gupta Sir and Dr. Kavita Sharma Ma'am for moderating the session. I would also like to thank all the delegates of the conference for thoroughly attending the session for the maximum takeaways. I would like to thank the technical team for the smooth conduction of this plenary session as well. Thank you all and a good day ahead as well. For all of your information, the next concurrent session, technical session will start from 2 p.m. Fine. Thank you all of you.
Thank you. Pragya ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.
To all. Thank you, Namrata madam. Thank you very much.
Fine. Thank you.
चल रही थी मेरे के वो गूगल से चला थी
नहीं, 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 नहीं,